Okay, enough already. This is the last take. Even if this one sucks, I'm still using it. I don't care. This is Jay Brown Yoga Talks Podcast. My name is Jay Brown. If you're new to the show, welcome. Everyone else, you have to forgive me. I'm having a moment over here. And there's no reason for it. I've got all the time and space that I've ever wanted to do this, and yet I'm still having a hard time. You see, my wife, she took my two daughters to go to some outdoor holiday lighting event that was organized by one of the moms as, I think, a last huzzah because apparently we're going to be locking down again, maybe. And my wife could just feel that, like, I was in, like, a very raw emotional place. Like, she knows me well, and she could see it in my eyes, and she knew that I wanted to do my tech fast tomorrow, and that in order to do that, it's really best if I could record today, and she knew that I didn't want to go to this thing, and so she gave me a pass. She gave me a pass. She said, I'll take the girls. You stay home. She gave me this time. And, you know, I did a practice, and I thought, oh, I'll really get myself into a good place. You know, I'm always under such tight constraints. But, you know, it's funny, having all this time and space actually feels like it made it harder. Like when I have a smaller window and I just have to focus in and, like, make it happen, sometimes that's very conducive to making it happen. But when I had all this time and space, it felt harder. And then when I finally did sit down to do it, my neighbor started mowing his lawn at 5:30 on a Friday. So in any case, it's been a whole process of trying to get myself to the mic here to talk to you. And just now, while I was waiting for my neighbor to finish mowing his lawn, I was in my kitchen and I was listening to the Beastie Boys' Check Your Head, which is an album I loved in college, and I haven't listened to it in so many years. And I was, like, dancing, and, like, nobody else was home. And I was, like, really releasing myself into the reverie of that, of just, like, just letting go into the music. And as soon as I did, I started sobbing uncontrollably. Like, as soon as I was able to relax enough to just give over to the reverie, I was overcome by intense sadness. And it's understandable. Because whatever modicum of relief some of us may be feeling over the election, it's totally overshadowed by the news of the pandemic. There's increasing case numbers across the country. Everybody's on high alert, even where I am, where there has been some increase, but our hospitals are not overrun like South Dakota. We're not anywhere near where we were back in whatever it was, May, when we had that whatever first wave. But still, everybody's like, okay, we gotta shut it all back down almost. Like, that's the feeling. Because we don't want to have a big increase again. And of course, it's understandable. But it means that people are feeling a need to shut the pods down some. And that's happened to us, one of the families in our pod. A pretty significant one. If you've been around, you've heard me talk about my eldest daughter getting to have her best friend. And that best friend, her grandparents are coming to move here. So her parents feel like they need at least, you know, 2 weeks of full quarantine to be safe before they come. And of course, you don't want to get your parents or grandparents sick. Of course not. And there's this article that mom read, and she circulated it to all the other moms. And it was written by a mom just like them in another state who had been doing similar pods and doing what she thought was safe. But then she had some people over, not even a big group, but everybody at the gathering ended up getting COVID, and she felt horrible about it. And she's basically said, please don't be irresponsible like I was. You don't want to risk getting anybody sick. We have to stop the pods. We have to lock down until there's a vaccine. And all the moms are like, oh no, maybe we're being irresponsible. Maybe we need to stop doing these pods we've been doing. And, you know, for me, of course, I want us to be as safe as we can, but I read the article and there was one very significant part of the story that was so underscored as to almost not register, which was that everyone who got sick in that story ended up being okay. And that's a beautiful thing. And I'm not suggesting that means we shouldn't worry about anything or that there's no such thing as a pandemic. There's plenty of people who don't end up being okay. There's a lot of people who've died from this thing. But everybody who was referred to in that story who got it ended up being okay. And I think that's a significant fact that should also be taken into account. As I've said before, I don't think it is wise for people to be operating from a place of like panic and fear. I just don't think we're making sensible decisions from that place. And, you know, I feel like articles like that are almost irresponsible because those aren't public service announcements coming from public health officials where in a rational way, they're saying to people, hey, we are observing an increase of cases and we are concerned that we're going to have a new wave of outbreak. We need everybody to be more vigilant than we have been. We need to put in some new restrictions and get through this third wave. Here are some recommendations. And even, you know, recommending that nobody go home for Thanksgiving. Okay, maybe that is a recommendation that we should follow. I don't know. But all I know now is my eldest daughter is super upset because she can no longer see her friend. And my younger daughter is waking up in the middle of the night crying and, you know, for no reason. And it just, it's all ongoing and difficult. And I'm downstairs dancing to the Beastie Boys and then crying uncontrollably. So I don't know why I'm telling anybody that. I don't know why I'm telling any of you that. I'm just dumping all this out here, but it's the only way to try to bring myself to talk to you because I can't bullshit you and just like pretend like the world doesn't feel shitty. And I got to imagine that I'm not the only one who feels similarly confused and upset. And you know what else I really think it is? It's just that it's coming to be the end of the year. It's like already mid-November. At this time of the year, I always like to come up with a bit of a game plan for next year. Like to start to like do like a little envisioning, like a little vision boarding in my head for myself about, you know, what I want to do or what I think is before me. And there's no game plan right now. There's no way to plan anything. I guess there's some people who are trying to book some events with the caveat that they might need to be changed, but it's just unclear if there are even venues. And even if I just carry on with what I was planning to do, which is just get my own spaces. It's just not clear if people are feeling comfortable to come together still. So I'm feeling at a loss, my friends. I'm looking for glimmers of, you know, like some light at that end of the tunnel. And it's still like, I can't find it yet. I'm still like walking through the dark, you know? And that's a good metaphor. We were talking about that in my teacher's class a couple weeks ago, I think, about this metaphor of like walking through the dark. Maybe your hand is against the wall as you go, but you can't see where you're going and you have to kind of give over and just walk through the dark. And I guess I'm wanting to see a glimmer of light ahead and I'm not seeing it quite yet. And part of it for me also is wanting to have an idea for myself about when that light does come, what am I doing? Are we doing the same things that we were doing before this all happened? Do we just pick back up where we were? I really don't think that's possible. And I've just been really wanting to kind of take an account of what was happening before this all shut down, like to get clear on, you know, what was going on at these centers and the way we were doing business and the way we were doing these like traveling teacher gigs. So the next couple of conversations you're going to hear on the show have to do with this. Today's conversation is with Lucie Vogel. Lucie emailed me years ago, and there was sort of this strange convergence that happened to bring this conversation about. You'll hear, Lucie is a survivor of the Dawn Yoga cult, who has gone on to earn a degree in law so that she can prosecute cults on behalf of survivors. And she recently published an article exposing that Matthew Remsky filed a lawsuit against Jenny Wilkinson Priest. I don't know if you know who Matthew Remsky and Jenny Wilkinson Priest are. They've both been on the show in the past. There's a whole situation there, which I'm involved in some, you'll hear. And there was just this, like I said, kind of convergence of things that happened. And for me, it has to do with some kind of reckoning over not only the way we were operating as an industry, but how we are going to hold each other to account. If you were here last week, we were talking about the future Buddha is the Sangha. And how are we going to do that? How are we going to create new social contracts where we're not creating these stratified situations where nobody can hold the teacher accountable because the teacher's like higher than everybody else? Like, how do we do the work of yoga and even the business involved with yoga in a way that doesn't just fall back into the same shitty patterns? Today's conversation with Lucie was a start to this inquiry. There will be some others to follow. I was very grateful to Lucie for speaking with me as candidly as she did. I'm excited for you to hear it today. Real quick before we do, let me say something to any of you who are currently managing a schedule of classes beyond just yourself. Like if you have a roster of teachers that you're managing, whether that's through in-person or virtual studios, maybe you're still using MindBody Online. I want to humbly suggest that you check out today's sponsor, Karmasoft. Longtime listeners have heard me talk about Karmasoft for years. It's the studio management software that I used when I had my yoga center in Brooklyn. The owner, Rudy Senegal, he's been on this show. Go back and listen to it. I was just talking to him recently, and he's got a whole range of things that he's doing to work with people and help them through this time. You're definitely going to get more individualized attention and service than you're going to get anywhere else. So maybe now is the time to check out Karmasoft. Go to karmasoftonline.com. Also, let me mention that this episode is brought to you in support by podcast premium subscribers like Stuart Usner, what's up, Stuart, and Katharina Adolf. We are so grateful to Stuart and Katharina and all of our podcast premium subscribers. If you're someone who's been listening to the show and you'd like to show some support, or maybe you want access to the extensive archives of the show, becoming a podcast premium subscriber is the way to do it. It's a choose your rate, and if you are not able to afford anything right now, you can send us an email and we will totally give you a free account. But if you can afford to do something right now, it makes such a huge difference for us, and we are so grateful. To learn more about becoming a podcast premium subscriber or find out about any of my other stuff, my weekly live stream classes, the weekly teacher's call, or any of my on-demand videos, You can find all of my stuff at jbrownyoga.com. Okay, y'all. I think that'll be it. I'll touch base with you on the other side. Maybe I can find a more level-headed place to send us off on. But for now, let's just go ahead and get to this conversation that I had with Lucie Vogel. Well, Lucie, it's good to meet you, and I appreciate you, you know, giving me some time today. We don't know each other at all, and I'm appreciative that you accepted my invitation.
Yeah. I remember, I think I've encountered your work around the same time that I first encountered Rimsky's work, and your thing at that time was gentle is the new advanced.
Mm-hmm. Still is.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And that's something that I've learned in my yoga practice, that for most of us in aging adult bodies, that's really where it's at. So I have been familiar with your work over the years. I don't follow anybody closely at this point, you know, because I've been in law school. I've kind of been focused on that and politics and, you know, running my businesses and stuff like that. But, you know, you're someone that I've kind of lightly touched in on throughout the year. So it's cool to be here.
Yeah. Well, I have to say it feels like a very circuitous path, and there was definitely some convergences for me that brought us together in this moment.
Yeah.
You know, just to, for anybody listening, you did recently write this article about Matthew Rimsky and a lawsuit he has against Jenny Wilkinson Priest. And someone sent me a link to that article, and for some reason, I really can't explain why the name of the author, Lucie Vogel, right?
Yeah.
For some reason, I remembered it. I was like, why do I know that name? And so I just, on a whim, decided to do like a search of my archived emails. Like I'm kind of an email hoarder. Like I have like a lot of old emails stored.
Mm-hmm.
And I also do a thing where if somebody listens to the show and sends me an email and they have like a suggestion for something that might be interesting for me to talk about, or they're like recommending a guest, sometimes it's not like it doesn't fit with what's happening, or it doesn't happen right then, and I just put it in a folder. And so I was searching through my emails, and an email from you back in like, I don't know, like 2016 or something, like many years ago, was in that folder. I believe it was maybe, I don't know if it was after talked with Andrew Tanner or Matt, it was with Matthew Rimsky actually. But you were specifically referencing Dawn Yoga because it had come up with me and Andrew.
Yeah.
And I remember, I've always had it in mind, oh, I have to have a conversation about Dawn Yoga, because I remember seeing the Dawn Yoga centers everywhere at one point.
Yeah. At one point, they were in position to be the biggest yoga provider in the country, if not the world. So mm-hmm.
I used to teach at a place in Brooklyn, and there was one right around the corner.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was like, oh, I got to always talk about that. And then, so was this kind of bizarre convergence of this article about Rimsky, which we can get to. And I have all kinds of like, I'm kind of involved in it on some level. And then you and your whole story about Dawn Yoga, I did read that article you sent me. And I have to say, it was really, I don't know, it was very resonant. I don't know if you watched the recent show, the Vow about Nexium, and he just got sentenced to life in prison like yesterday or something, that guy. Are you familiar with that story?
Yeah, I am. I have a mutual friend who is related to one of the defendants, Claire Bronfman. So talk about kind of circuitous connections, but I have followed it closely because of that, and also because they have had a very successful legal process. You know, there was a criminal prosecution of Rainier That's not something that ever happened with my cult leader or with most cult leaders, but they were able to successfully do that. And, you know, a lot of the legal basis that they used is something that you would use with any group like that. So I was familiar with the law background, and it was great to see them succeed, because issues of undue influence, psychological manipulation, you know, the stuff that we're trying to unearth in these conversations of yoga abuse happening while we're trying to transform, and there's also healing going on, it's very confusing and hard to parse out. So thought that was a super interesting case, especially that they've been so successful.
Yeah. And I don't know that, I mean, I guess that's a good precedent, because it hasn't been the case in the past always, as you were saying, in the case of this guy, what's his name at the head of Dawn Yoga?
His name is Ilchi Lee. We sued him in 2009, and the case went through federal court for about 4 years. The Last of Us settled our claims in 2013. And in terms of, you know, measurements of lawsuit success, in terms of, like, you know, winning money or getting a court to say, yes, you are right and no, you are wrong, we didn't get anything like that. The lawsuit was kind of a disaster, really, because it had at one point 30 plaintiffs, and we had a single attorney representing us, and on the side of the defendants, the yoga cult that we were suing, they had like 27 lawyers representing 9 different corporate defendants. It was like this kind of juggernaut of money and power, and kind of destined to fail through exhaustion. So, you know, I didn't get any money out of that. And basically, my settlement with them said that we released our claims, but we never disavowed them. So we basically agreed to disagree. You know, in terms of, you know, satisfaction that one gets out of a life process, you know, there's a lot else to be said about that. I certainly don't regret doing it, but we did not have a clear win like they did in Nexium, or, you know, for instance, the lawsuits against Mr. Bikram, you know, there's been a lot of damage to him. So things have definitely gotten better since I went through it.
Man, maybe for people listening who don't know about Dawn Yoga, we could go back and talk about it a little bit. I remember it must have been like in the early 2000s that I remember seeing those centers around Brooklyn, which aren't there anymore. When did you first come into contact with Dawn Yoga?
I was the same time, 2000. I was going to college in the Boston area. I went to MIT, and I had like tried out a couple of yoga classes and heard about yoga. And then I fractured my sacrum when I was 18 and wanted to do pain management without getting into the hard drugs, because they were starting to prescribe those opioids, the crazy opioids in the late 90s. So I just had this intuition that that was going to be bad for me. So I thought, well, yoga could help. So I found an advertisement in Cambridge, in Central Square in Cambridge, for a Dawn Center in Brookline, which is, if you know Boston, is not the same town. So they were, you know, plastering the area. Especially they wanted to get people connected with all the local colleges. So I was one of those people, and I saw a flyer and I went in, and I had a really great experience until I didn't, you know, and that's part of what was so confusing about it. It helped with my pain. It helped with stress. I made all these new friends. I had all these kind of existential angst things I was dealing with.
As most 20 somethings have.
Right. You know, just, you know, it really, really helped. I mean, you know, we call it Dawn Yoga. You know, Dawn is from Korea. It's not technically yoga. they added the word yoga for a while because of marketing purposes. And then
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but that's very interesting to hear you say that, because that was kind of going to be my next question. I just remember them having really slick kind of marketing. I just had a conversation with a guy named Jeff Krasno, who started Wanderlust Festival, like that big yoga festival. And he was sort of talking about at one point around that time where yoga teachers just weren't very good, or yoga centers always weren't very good when it came to like marketing, and they would use like low res images that were all fuzzy and like not good fonts and stuff, you know? And Dawn Yoga really had like a really tight marketing. And I remember someone I knew who was going there, and I was into yoga, and I was like trying to have a conversation with them, and it didn't seem like any yoga that I had heard of. She said something that was like very personalized, like you would have like a one-to-one meeting, and it was much more like she tried to describe it more as like a therapeutic yoga, like a yoga therapy kind of thing or something.
Yeah, you know, it varied from center to center. And, you know, in terms of what was it connected to, you know, in Asia, they do like a lot of seniors do like calisthenics in the parks. So there was a lot of that stuff. And then they do have martial arts and like, you know, Qigong. So there was some of that. And then, you know, we know the history of, you know, yoga and Buddhism and how it has spread all over Asia. And, you know, so there, you know, were people who had grown up Buddhist in a Korean Buddhist culture and then got into this stuff. So it was just this hodgepodge, mishmash. And, you know, speaking of the marketing thing, it was kind of constantly evolving, trying to get people's attention rather than trying to be one particular thing.
Interesting. It did seem kind of nebulous, I guess, by design.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, since I sued them, they've completely changed their name. they're called the Body and Brain Centers now. They have a completely different corporate structure. So, you know, they have responded to criticism over the years, many times. You know, when we went to Don Hawk, to Don Yoga, that was response to criticism of Don Hawk. And then, you know, the next evolution, you know, there was a lady who died on a hike in Sedona. And, you know, that's when we went from, you know, Don Hawk to Body and Brain or whatever. So they were constantly evolving.
Yeah. Well, you know, I guess I'm wondering, you know, I've had a number of conversations on this show where people have wanted to speak out about, you know, a teacher, let's say, who was abusive to them. And I've had to really educate myself about how to do that in a way where the person who's doing that can feel like heard and supported and stuff. And I've put out talks that are kind of calling out abuses in the yoga world. And almost every time I do, I will get emails from people who are like current students of that teacher or something.
Yeah.
And want to express a different view. And frankly, even just recently, I don't want to divulge too much. Like I actually recorded a conversation with somebody and I thought it was an amazing conversation. I was really thought it was important, but they've asked me not to post it. And it's so conflicting. And I don't think I am, out of respect to that person, in the same way that I would show respect to someone who did feel abused. I at this moment right now, I don't want to be forcing someone to make themselves a target in like social media or whatever, you know what I mean? And I think in the past I've done that. So it seems to me that it is, I know there's like a thing where it's very hard to bring to account when people are these predators, when they're like manipulating people, like in that show with the vow, or even from what I understand about what happened to you, it just seems like it's hard to prove that how they manipulated you when you were choosing to be there or whatever. Maybe you can, you know, say something to how it was for you that you managed to find yourself in this thing. How do you think it is that someone gets ensnared in something like this?
Yeah. So The research says that it's a thing that can happen to anyone. Like, people have tried to do studies about, like, what's the profile of a cult member? Do they have some vulnerability? You know, there's all these theories about stuff you're working out and why you're drawn to it. And none of that stuff bears out in reality when people try to measure it in terms of, like, actual people. But there are, you know, psychology is a difficult thing. I was talking to a psychologist recently about this issue, you know, because I'm looking at it now from a person who's studying the law. And when you have mental and emotional damages, those can be really, really hard to prove. And at the heart of it is, like, all of our psychological theories, there's not really any proof. You know, there are people who debate things and they overwhelm the conversation and they're considered, you know, the predominant forces, but it's not like medicine, you know, or math or science where, you know, you can do studies and take measurements and compare data. So that's kind of the heart of the issue. And it connects to how it happens to people. And it also connects to, you know, what do you do about it? Sorry, my dogs are.
Yeah.
In the mountains, they're barking at some cars or something.
That's so, all right. We'll carry on. It won't be a problem that they're in the background. Everybody knows that you've got dogs now.
Okay, cool. Yeah. so the kind of the essential concept is undue influence. And undue influence is this idea that you can get into a privileged position of power over someone's life. And from that position, you have the power to take things from them that you wouldn't normally be able to take, and to get them to do things and behave in ways and act in ways that would not happen normally without the position of privilege. And it's that, you know, yoga, we have the guru student, you know, we have the therapist and the person receiving the therapy. We have the doctor and the patient. So there's all these examples where we have these privileged relationships. And in most of the places where those are acknowledged, there's some kind of duty. You know, lawyers are supposed to take care of their clients. Doctors are supposed to do no harm. Obviously, there's lots of evidence that people don't follow through it, but that's the spirit of it. And so with these spiritual groups, you have a leader and they have a special position. And if it's a large group, they have a bunch of teachers under them who also have a special position. And at a certain point entering into the group, they have this power over you. And it's the same power dynamic that we have in all the different relationships. But in this group, they get to decide how to use it and what's okay to do and what's not okay to do. And then it gets into all this corrupt stuff. You know, it always ends up being about money. There always ends up being sexual abuse and, you know, marriages destroyed and relationships ruined. You know, the stories that you hear, the things that happen to me, they've happened to people all over the place in many different groups. It's not unique to me. It's not unique to any of us, but, you know, you have this power differential, and it just takes a while to break free from it. And, you know, there's all this stuff about cult exit therapy and, you know, cult recovery and trauma recovery and all these different things. And again, a lot of it, there's not really any proof. There's lots of theories, but nobody knows what really works. And at the end of the day, it's really about free will and free choice. And there's, at some point, the human spirit seems to want to escape from these bonds, and you start to realize and recognize. And it is literally like you wake up and all of a sudden you start to look around and go, whoa, things are not what I thought that they were. It's really strange, but it happens to a lot of people. And then, you know, from there you try and tell the story. And then, as you said, there's everybody who criticizes you and there's lots of fighting on the internet and maybe there's some lawsuits and who really knows what the truth is.
Yeah. I mean, in particular these days, that seems even more true than at other times. Maybe it's always been the same, but there's just such a wash of information. I'm wondering How long were you involved in Dawn Yoga?
7 years.
7 years. Yeah. And were you, did you become a teacher? You did the training, like how far along in the, isn't there like levels that you work through in the organization or back when you were doing it at least?
Yeah. There's like practitioner levels and like teacher levels and professional levels. I was pretty far along in the group. Andrew Tanner, he was like, we were like buddies and like competitors. Like he and I ran the two most successful Dawn centers in the country.
So you ran a center.
I ran a center. I managed like 9 centers. So I at an early age, I got a lot of management experience as well.
How old were you when you were doing that?
I got my first management position right out of college. I was 24.
Wow. And then
three years later, I was pretty far up in the organization. So it wasn't that hard to do. I mean, people left frequently and,
what do you mean people like staff or students? What are you referring to when you say people left?
Yeah. Like there was just a constant cycling through of the hierarchy, you know, like if you knew someone who'd been there longer than 10 years, that was pretty special, but the organization had been around for 20, 25 years at that point. So, you know, people, there's a lot of it relies on all of the groups. They rely on, you know, cycling of people, getting fresh people, kind of rinse and repeat the process.
All right. So, I mean, the other thing I was going to say before is that it always is a little bit, I don't know, murky, because very often people got like real benefit. Like people sometimes still use practices they learned, or like, you know, there was like a lot of good. And then, like I was saying, there's people who were in the sometimes the same classes and didn't have the same experience and think that person is being unreasonable or something. I'm wondering, when did you first notice, when did it first start to occur to you that something wasn't right about this?
Well, you know, I heard about stuff on the internet pretty early on, but I kind of just pushed it to the side. And then there were some controversies that happened while I was in the group. Somebody died, Julius Siverles died at a training. And that kind of pushed against my mental boundaries pretty strongly. And at first you kind of, you know, you dig in and you double down and, you know, you fight it. But there's these kind of internal conversations that are going on. And then, as I said, it's very confusing because, you know, I got benefits from Dawn, and that was part of the whole confusion in the lawsuit. Is they're like, well, how can you say that you were manipulated when you also benefited? And I'm like, well, I can, because that's what happened, you know. But in terms of having a good lawsuit, it's really tricky. You know, for me, I started to get health impacts, you know, because it was a very rigorous lifestyle. There was not much sleep. We had a really controlled environment. We did poses for extreme amounts of time, you know, stuff that I've learned about how the body works now. I mean, I was just, you know,
stress positions. They were putting you in stress positions.
Yeah. I literally was breaking my body thinking I was overcoming something, you know, and I still live with that stuff today. So, you know, at a certain point, and I heard this from a lot of people, the health stuff starts to catch up to you. Like, you know, there's a cognitive dissonance of like, I did this because it was supposed to be this great lifestyle that would move me on this path of self-development. And, you know, here I am and I'm miserable and exhausted and my body's falling apart. Like what's wrong here? So
what were the benefits then? You said that you had, like, the confusion was, how could you have been manipulated and also received benefit? What were some of the benefits? Like initially you said, like, you had back pain that got better. Were there other things besides just feeling physically better? Although I guess that backfired later.
Yeah. You know, lots of the exercises, if you don't do them in the extreme, they're good. I mean, there's a million variations of yoga, right? The things we could call yoga. Hmm. Physical movement that's healthy for us, or whatever you want to call it. So that stuff, there's lots of different movements. And I think I think I learned how to pay attention there. And maybe that was misdirected and it was used against my own self best interest for a while, but I did learn how to go inside of myself. I did learn that process of turning the inner gaze to the inner sensation and penetrating the levels of awareness inside. And, you know, that's pretty universal.
I know, but see, that's what makes it more disgusting in a way, because yeah. That thing that you just described, that yoga of being able to go inward and recognize our interconnectedness and like the real beauty of why people are attracted to yoga. And then to have that used as essentially like a tool for manipulation to get money from people and even like to abuse people sexually, as I read about.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I've wanted to quit yoga many times, but. Oh.
Well, but you can't, I mean, whatever, you can't. I mean, quit yoga. I don't know what it means. Like you have your yoga, right? So how do you quit your yoga? I mean, exactly. Not like yoga as an institution, right? But like yoga as your observed experience.
Yeah. You know, I went through a period after I left the group where I was bitter about everything and everything was wrong and everything was bad. And I think it's good to go through that kind of process. Like, you know, look at Bikram, for instance, you know, that whole revelation of who he is. And then that practice itself is arguably pretty violent practice. And so, you know, you can go through your yoga and you can look at, you know, how do those sicknesses show up in how you do the practice?
I mean, that's an interesting thing that you're saying. I mean, I, on some level, think I can agree with you about it, there being a kind of violence to it. But I know there's people who would debate that, who don't find it to be violent to move their body in a rigorous way or even challenge their body. But I do think what you're saying is interesting. To me, it's not always about the forms. Like, I think I could teach those 26 poses and 2 breathing exercises in a way that was in line with Gentle is the New Advanced. But I would have to be able to make changes and like people would have to be able to rest if they want, you know what I mean? Like it's more about like pedagogy or methodology or something about the way you go, like the pose in and of itself is a problem, but making someone hold it there, because if they don't, they're not going to work.
If you are hearing this message, then you're listening to the free version of Jay Brown Yoga Talks. To hear the rest of our conversation, please subscribe to Podcast Premium at jbrownyoga.com/premium.